finished.
22 years ago, I celebrated the victory of Robert Mugabe, Zimbabwe's first democratically elected leader. The liberation movement and its 17-year struggle had finally brought an end to racist colonial rule. Mugabe's clear vision for the country and the region's future made him a hero of mine, and Zimbabwe was viewed by the rest of the world as a model African state.
I wish to assure you that the support we have, we will not put to ill use.
My family was part of the South African liberation movement. We were in exile for many years and had close contact with Mugabe's ZANU party. The Zimbabweans were the first to win their freedom, and my family was invited to live in their country. It was a time of hope. Then in 1990, Zimbabwe's neighbor, South Africa, also found democracy, and I returned home. But in the last few years, Zimbabwe has changed. The world's press has been filled with stories of political violence, illegal occupations of white-owned farms, and a collapsing economy. Things seem to be going from bad to worse. Having spent 20 years in power, President Mugabe was up for re-election. In the months before, I decided to go to Zimbabwe. I needed to see for myself what had gone so wrong. Two contenders in Zimbabwe's presidential election have been locked in a war of words and violence. Mugabe's challenger is Morgan Tsvangirai, the Movement for Democratic Change, or MDC. His background is in the trade union movement, and his policies center around economic recovery and accountable government. Mugabe's platform focuses on fast-track land reform, which is presented as the final victory over the country's former colonial power. Two years ago, white-owned commercial farms were occupied by war veterans, loyal to Mugabe. I wanted to start my trip by visiting such a farm. These have become the front line of conflict and the center of Mugabe's land reform program. Mick and Fred Rose invited me to their tobacco farm in Mashonaland East.
Those are my lands, up to the hills there. The farm boundary where that tall spiral rock is, and then south.
My brother-in-law's father bought the original farm in 1925. Very old Zimbabwean family. My side of the family, I'm third generation. So we're looking at 75, 76 years of sort of occupation of the Whaleys in this area.
We should be, for the coming season, preparing right now. We can't do it. That's the basis of your crop, is early land preparation. Can't do it.
The war vets came and said that if we didn't stop plowing our lands, they would burn the tractors and beat the tractor drivers up. So we shut down.
On the farm, we are literally surviving. We are staying, hoping that we will be able to farm again, hoping that we can get the labor back and we can continue to farm again.
There have been a couple of incidents. The threats so far haven't come to fruition.
What are these threats?
That they're going to kill my wife and myself, burn the place, level the place. Because we're an MDC farm, or supposedly an MDC farm, and that's it.
I wanted to hear the other side of the story. I didn't have to travel far. On the farm next door, a ZANU youth camp had been set up. Manned by young men and some war veterans, it was there to monitor and politically influence the local farm workers. The war vets at the base camp introduced me to Comrade Kilawani, a high-ranking war veteran and committed ZANU PF member.
For us, the foremost thing was the land. This is exactly what we fought for. We wanted the land. We fought against the system. We're fighting race. No. We were fighting only to have this peace. Where I can control myself. Where I can exercise my interests. It's only now. It's unfortunate people will tame us as combatants. We are not combatants. Please.
What are you?
We are freedom fighters.
Patakatanga kuuya tichitsvaga ivhu. Washandi vemumapurazi vanga vasingadi kuti isusu tiuye kunotsvaga ivhu, nekuti vaifungidzira kuti ivo isusu tikanga tauya vachazoshaya basa kuvarungu, nekuti minda pane pasina yekushanda. Saka vaitumwa nevarungu manje vachiuya kunotirwisa manje. Washandi vemumapurazi vaigona kuuya vachingotaura imwe yeya kuti vanotamba, vanofunga kuti vangatorere murungu minda here, vachiuya ivo vanhu vari kutambura zvakadai avo, vari kutambisa chii? Varikutambisa nguva. Saka paizomboita kabongozozo zvapo pakati ipapa.
This is an office. That's where we are taken care of. People say war veterans cannot write, but we can also write. It's an office like another office. This is our council department. We are the servants of the people, not veterans who are still at war. That's the reception. We are organizers, we are professionals also. We are people. We are people. We have a reception.
It's very unfortunate. White people, they don't think a black man can even think. Why? A black man can't be a leader.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'm now home. That's where I feed from. That's where I think I make my things. From this small room, I'd have liked it to be a bit. I get emotional.
Zimbabwe's commercial farms rely on a force of more than 500,000 labourers. I returned to the farm where the war vets had their base. I wanted to talk to the workers to find out what it was like to be stuck between the farmers and the war veterans. I was introduced to a foreman called Big Boy. He's worked on the Hilton farm for 11 years and is the second generation of his family to do so. Big Boy was clearly worried about the conflict on the farm.
From the time they started to occupy the farm from last year, it doesn't seem to be all right.
They come and started burning the houses for no reason. We were so angry, but we had nothing to do. It was our headman said that we don't like to fight these people. And our boss came and said, please don't fight. The police will do their job.
Yeah, right now they say you are not allowed to plow anything in the compound. Well, they say this is a state land. You mustn't plow anything, you mustn't grow anything. So if you don't plant maize, there's hunger.
A lot of trouble with the farm labourers. Why is this?
With who now?
The farm labourers on the farms.
With who?
There seems to be fighting. There's been a history of fighting between the war vets and the farm labourers.
There's what we call colonial era. Because you're white. Yeah, it was.
So you're saying the farm, many of these farm labourers have a colonial mindset?
Yes.
They're colonised.
Yeah, that's what they have. That's what they are. It will take time for it to be out of my head. A white man is a better somebody.
Most people on the farm, they don't like to upset the farmer because he's still like the father of workers on the farm. Because everyone is depending on him. If someone is sick, then you can run to the boss and say, oh, my wife or child is sick and is going to provide you the truck and it takes you to the hospital.
They're telling you what you want to hear rather than what's the truth.
Correct. And we have the same problems. You never know what's really going on in their own minds and how the labour is actually thinking.
When you actually talk about your workers, I mean, a lot of them will say, in time of crisis, that come and say, you're my father, you're my baba. You know, I'm asking you for help as my baba. Who is he going to come to if he's in trouble?
The
one person that he's always come to, and he still regards. I think that hasn't left.
The end of colonialism brought little change to the lives of those who worked and lived off the land. When Mugabe's government came into power, they adopted a hands-off approach towards the ownership and working conditions on commercial farms.
I don't think anyone respects any land or natural resource unless he's paid for it and actually puts back into it what he's actually getting out of it. To actually just receive something for nothing, it's like a recalcitrant kid, 17 years old, give him a new car, he doesn't appreciate it because he hasn't worked for it himself.
The subsistence farmer is going to grow, he is going to grow the amount to feed his family. If he gets more, all well and good, that's great because he can sell it to put his inputs into the, you know, subsistency is to literally survive. And it's gone from hundreds of years and it's done very well for itself. We're not decrying subsistence farmers, peasants farming. It happens all over the world. That is not a criteria here. All I'm saying is that you have got to have your commercial farmers to feed the nation if that doesn't work. Like this year, devastation. And I mean,
farming is not a hobby. It's a vocation, and it's got to be done properly. You're actually just a landlord, and how you care for the land and what it repays you by nurturing it properly and farming it properly, agronomically, is something that only a farmer can feel. And for that to be wrenched away from you illegally and unjustly, it's hard.
They're not farmers anyway. In the way I know them, they're not farmers. They're just people who have resources. A farmer is me, who spends the day in the field, who will tell him, I need this, with that portion, he's just going by, leave it to me, and I'll do the work. He comes with his motorbike, sees what I've done. The whole day he's playing golf in town. They're not special, they take themselves. Mine is called a field, it's not a farm. His is called a farm, because it's white.
No farmers, no future. That's what I think. Because going back to subsistence farming, sure, we're deteriorating. We're going right down. That's where I say there's hunger. Because there will be no one growing anything for food. Sure, we'll die.
Okay, you're a freedom fighter. Your struggle for freedom, in this instance, the struggle for land, has meant people's other freedoms are trampled upon. This is what they're saying. The war veterans are leading a movement which is repressing other voices.
People think the independence they have just walked in the house. No, it was fought for. People died. Our government is led by detainees. Detainees are the ones running the country at the moment. There's a war veteran. He has to come in. Then a war veteran's son follow the queue.
Kilawani and many fellow war veterans believe that in having sacrificed their lives for an independent Zimbabwe, they should have been included in the building of a new nation. Listening to Kilawani, I realized that in heeding the call, land to the people, he genuinely believed that he was completing the process of national liberation that had begun decades ago.
Mararum, Kunataga, Esnish, Asquanik. Sandra didn't do Nipandu in Gudorima. Otherwise, in the day in Shuanagura Magurinani. Moreover, I didn't go out, I was in Damuana Bass. Assistiru Jashikango Penjin. That Benjamin and Dagoyago no Kumba. Need Dagona Pekugar. The Gashiga Mindesia Toro, whenever I'm in the Snapang Pantinabo. The Nosurama say. Sagagutong and Dor Nepekung and Jigara Fest, does no track a bass, the Don and Dope from Waganak.
Zimbabwe was a former British colony called Rhodesia. Its colonization 100 years ago was spurred on by the world's voracious appetite for gold. The promise of a second reef like that found in Johannesburg, South Africa, never materialized. But they found another type of gold, highly fertile soil. The indigenous population fought against the colonizers, but were crushed. And by the 1930s, all the highly fertile land was in the hands of white colonials. Farming since then has been central to the economic and political development of the country. The processing of crops like tobacco, cotton and coffee in the 1960s ensured impressive economic growth, providing one of the world's highest living standards, but only for the privileged white minority.
It's a very small world for Zimbabweans. You either played some sport against him, or you were at school with him, or you were in the army with him, and I don't think there's a town in this country that I don't know someone in, or did.
Describe your life.
What sort of life did you start then? What did you
do? School, sport. What else?
How did you entertain yourself?
Mainly sport. Rugby, cricket, motocross, tennis, golf. Still play a bit of squash and a lot of golf.
What was that?
In those years, I mean, that was my life. My horses.
Tell us a bit about life in colonial Rhodesia, about your life.
There's one day I recall my father came home, picked us to his workplace in town in a train. My father got asleep in the train. There's this guard, a white guy. My father was asleep. He had the tickets. They were searching for tickets. When my father, sleeping as he was, you see this punch thing. They used to punch tickets. He was hit on the head. Ticket! When my father woke up, he was a white man. They were so scary, the white men. My father couldn't even find the tickets, yet he had the tickets in his pocket.
Okay.
He was hit in front of me. After a time, he got the tickets. I didn't hate a white man, but they made me hate them.
Big Boy invited me to his home in the reserves. Most of the farm workers come from the poverty-stricken communal lands. They are parcels of poor quality land, allocated by the old colonial government.
Hello.
Yeah.
See you again.
Yeah. Nice.
Nice to see you. Nice to be at home.
Yeah.
Some foremen were taken at your farm just a couple of weeks ago.
Yes.
Why are they targeting the foremen?
They're targeting the foremen because the foreman is too close to the white man. That's why they'll be looking at the foremen. They want to threaten all the foremen. And they think the white men are all MDC.
Is your boss MDC?
No. And he doesn't like to talk about political issues also.
What happened after we left you last time?
You left me in trouble. Because those people, the settlers, they thought maybe I brought MDC on the farm.
Were you scared?
Yes, I'm scared of that. The last time you came there, I was very, very worried. Otherwise, sometimes, because I've been hearing some rumors each and every day. They're coming this afternoon, they're coming this evening, they're coming this afternoon. And sometimes I had to go out in my house and sleep somewhere. Because I'll be thinking maybe they'll come and collect me at any time.
I decided to reassure the war vets on Big Boy's farm that I had nothing to do with the opposition party. Initially, things went well.
Zvingatoitika kuri kune dzimwe nzvimbo otherwise kunenge kuri kure nemabases but ma areas aka ane mabases ari mukati mao hazvisikwanisika kuita nekuti izvozvi kutaura kuno vamwe vedu vazhinji vasiri paramba vatori mapato kuchengetedza runyararo kuti runge ruri runongoramba ruri pespace chero usiku hatisi kurara tinongorara tichifamba kuitira kuti tinge tinochengetedza nzvimbo yedu kuti zvuita kuti murove nerunyararo mese mese zvekuti hapana kanogona kuitika pakati peusiku tikatadza kukaziva kuti kwaitika kakati panzvimbo yakati.
Then things turned sour. The war vets kept the crew and interrogated them. I was taken to the nearest town, questioned and threatened by the senior war vets and later the police.
Pass me the camera.
We were left shaken in the knowledge that we narrowly averted, at best, a thorough beating, and at worst, murder. Although still sensing danger, I was determined to clear up any misunderstanding between myself and the war vets. and prevent Big Boy from being harmed. After a few meetings with the war vets, it was decided that we could return to Hilton Farm.
I think it's one of the things which has to be discussed about. Because but who is the vet?
To ensure our safety, we were accompanied by Comrade Danzvara, the head of the local War Veterans Association. He suggested we call in on the farm owner.
Now, up until now, I've been very quiet, all right? And then now, suddenly, all the sort of nyaya is starting to come out. They're starting to give a hard time to my management, saying that the management was MDC and we are promoting MDC. That's why the pastor was chased away, because he said he's promoting MDC material.
Okay.
And whatnot, but he's just a pastor and he's teaching the things of God. And the gospel, he's not teaching MDC.
Okay. I think it's one of the things which has to be discussed about.
Every time I gather together like this, there's somebody watching somewhere.
Okay.
And they're going to report over there, oh, they're meeting again.
Oh. So if you try to gather your people, tell them the job we want to be done, that they think you are promoting MDC?
Yeah, but I'm not.
Yes, you are not. You are definitely not. Just to say,
all your workforce joining ZANU?
They all have to have a card. Right? Because if they go traveling somewhere and they haven't got a card, they will get a hiding. So everyone needs to buy a card to be able to travel at the moment.
Okay.
I need. That's basically the story.
That's basically this is what happened. But,
why have they got youth here now? I mean, we've been sitting like this nicely for 2 years now.
Okay.
And now suddenly they've got to have a youth base over here.
Yeah, the problem is this, Mr. Zay. It's only since you know that there's a against between this ZANU-PF and the MDC. And I think this directive come from the president, as mm-hmm. far as I know, so that the youth not work very hard, so that there's no even one of the members of MDC who enter in the farms.
Mm-hmm.
That's where I think that is the program. But after election, I think it will be peacefully, and they are not going to stay. They must have their own.
Musha.
They are not going to stay forever.
Sure.
It's only definite, I'm telling you.
So what's happening after elections? Will you go back farming again?
I think what we're promising is to say, you're going to remain here as far as I know.
Hoping that Comrade Danzvara could guarantee our safety, I confronted the war vets.
This farmer is saying that you're saying all his people are MDC and he's MDC and that you're giving him trouble. What do you say?
No, we don't know that. We don't know that. We didn't come across.
And he says you took some of his people, it's the pastor, and you gave them a rough time and you beat one guy across the buttocks.
We don't know that. We didn't come across.
Where is that guy which was beaten? Where is he? Where is
him?
When we came here last time, he said some months ago that the comrades burnt the workers' houses, and Comrade Chibanda here was taken to court, and that he can't go near the workers' compound.
Normally, that is. Might be some of the workers who burned those houses. They pretend that they change the statement that these are the settlers who burned the houses. I think that's what happened.
Really?
Not these settlers to burn the houses. They won't do that. Okay. Even our party structure does not allow to do that.
Okay. With just days to go before the election, Kilawani was in good spirits. Much to my surprise, he invited me over to lunch at his mother's house.
My mother, she made me what I am. Some people strangle kids. She had that courage to make me what I am. She's a mother.
Ngangibona umntanami
uphakathi kwempi uphakathi kokuphila ufa kimi ngiyiki hlezi nje ukuthi angazi inkosi yini ofileyo ukuphila kini solamo kona boka ngiyazi sekuphileni sekufeni sekuthabeni sekuphileni. Ye, umhlabathi lesintu kuyangenika nokuba savela sadabuka sizalwa silima. Kulinywa silakho ngokudlala. Futhi silima ngezandla singalimika. Kwakulinywa kakhulu. Inhlabathi iqakathekile kakhulu lesintu. Yiyo mpilo yethu ilobhanga lethu inhlabathi.
I discovered that Kilawani's family had a long and involved history with the liberation movement. His brother died during the war.
He left the country in 1963 to join the liberation struggle in Zambia. That's where we were told he passed away. It was February the 7th at UTH, that's hospital in Lusaka. That's where he passed away.
He found young Jesus or Fela Elise. Yuko engucela enkosini ukuthi inkosi mayilibusise ilikhokheleni elele laphana uyihlo uyaziqhenya ngani uyazi ukuthi ngilamakhawe emhlabeni alwela ilizwe ngiyacela kakhulu ukuba na inkosi ikhokheleni.
He was laid to rest nearby the late Joshua Gumbi. He touched me the day he was buried here. That's what really made me take off from where he left. And I crossed the border also.
Wayne Zanu recognized from the beginning that this system which was being operated by the white minority regime here was evil. It was tyrannical. Therefore, we ought to abolish it, put an end to it. The main question was how. Our conclusion was only armed struggle would get us liberated.
We, the government of Rhodesia, in humble submission to Almighty God, who controls the destinies of nations.
In 1965, the Rhodesian government of Ian Smith defied British demands for black majority rule. Breaking their colonial ties, they made a unilateral declaration of independence.
Enact and give to the people of Rhodesia the constitution annexed hereto. God save the Queen.
Look out!
The liberation war, called the Second Chimurenga, gained momentum. A guerrilla army of 50,000 men and women engaged an embattled colonial outpost that numbered a mere 250,000 whites.
I did 5 years in the Rhodesian army.
Tell us some stories.
Ah, you wouldn't like to hear them.
He doesn't tell them. This is really, he's never told me, so I...
Really? It's tough.
Oh, he talks about the good times. And the funny stories.
Tell you about some good parties.
And chased by rhinos and elephant and that sort of thing, yes. But nothing of the bad stuff, no.
There was a bombardment. That was 1978. In my camp. But I'll tell you, I was lucky. But I think that was good. I only lost 3 guys in that bombardment. That's where I lost this foot. This is what happened. There's a chemical in napalm which had been used.
In the late 1970s, after years of brutal fighting, the Rhodesians finally entered into negotiations with the liberation movement. An agreement was reached at Lancaster House in London, and it paved the way for Zimbabwe's first democratic elections. ZANU-PF won a landslide victory. It was a great moment for all involved in liberation politics. It was proof that a powerful white minority regime could be beaten. It was a highly emotional time for all of us.
Having been through all those years of war, it's not like a light switch, you just switch on and off. I mean, everyone was very tentative and treaded gently. I thought, in fact, there was going to be a witch hunt. I thought there was going to be... But there wasn't. I listened, and that's... I think the country actually improved. I listened, it just went from strength to strength. We got on with farming, developed the farms, ploughed money straight back into the land and got going.
Legislation was introduced in 1987 that allowed the state to purchase 650 commercial farms on a willing buyer, willing seller basis. This was the beginnings of a resettlement program for the landless poor. However, it was soon discovered that a number of the farms purchased ended up in the hands of high-up government officials and their cronies.
I deny that Zimbabwean ministers enriched themselves here in any way by corrupt means.
The war veterans, an important ally of the government, began demanding the ruling party honour their pledge to pay out wartime compensation. Faced with an expensive problem, Mugabe simply instructed the Reserve Bank to print more money. Not surprisingly, the value of the Zim dollar collapsed and food prices spiraled out of control. It was a recipe for civil unrest. And this led to the formation of the Movement for Democratic Change. Support for Mugabe was falling, while the MDC's popularity grew and grew.
Titanga Zepata, Constitution Yavan, Ino Gadirwanavan, Ishibeteravan, Queta Quita Constitution Yomun, Ino Defender Moon, Ishi Defender Party Meshete, Pasnas.
There has to be an opposition for one to move, but not in the manner the MDC is coming. They're using our fellow brothers, the fellow brothers, just for money. More gain, honestly. If I look at him, I can be, let's say, we're taken back to school, I can be his prefect.
Mugabe, he has used the racial card in a way in trying to resuscitate historical emotions. And he's trying to make Wise the scapegoat of all his failures on the land question, on the economy, and on everything. He's trying to revive another struggle when he has had the responsibility for the last 20 years to deal with those issues.
British lords, British companies, wealthy white South African families and companies have massive land holdings which they processed.
Following his narrow victory in the 2000 parliamentary elections, Mugabe launched his own land reform program, endorsing and then actively supporting war veteran-led farm invasions.
Utilized land when we demand land reform.
When you say I invaded, I don't think that's right. How can I invade my own place, my own thing? We're not invading. We are repossessing.
Mugabe has usurped the goodwill of the people. For 20 years, there was a complete shelving of the land reform program. Between 1980 and 1990, he only distributed 3.4 million hectares. The MDC came into being and said, we are going to take 7 million hectares out of white commercial interests to give it to the landless blacks. They came out in their manifesto with 5 million hectares. In fact, our policy on land was far more radical than ZANU-PF issue.
The presidential election campaign has come onto the farm. Is it making life tough?
I go going for about a week after a week, going for the meetings. They say it's compulsory. We have to go.
And why do you go?
We fear. Fear for our lives. Fear for our lives. Because if you don't go there, say then you're an opposition party, and you're in for a high jump. Sometimes they beat you. Oh, they want us to vote for the party.
Tirikudzidzisa vanhu maererano nemavhotero plus nemanakiro akaita bato redu rezanupf. Saka tinenge tichiedza kudzoredzana kune vamwe vanga vakarasika. Saka ndosaka tiri pabase. Tichiitawo futi kukondrora kuitira zviya zvekuti kana pakauya maenemies anenge achidawo kudaro tongogona kubatsirana nevamwe.
Kunyangwe vamwe vanogona kutaura vachidaro asi isu kunyangwe tikabata ari munhu weMDC hatina zvatinomita tinongomubvunza womubvunza hatinomubvunza. Kunyangwe akataura zvaanokwanisa kutaura hatigone kumurova kana kumudii.
Plasi isusu hatina kunzi tigorova vanhu. Mutemo wakanga uripo ndewekuti munhu akanga aonekwa kuti ndewe MDC.
But how is the relationship between the farm workers and the comrades, yeah, the settlers?
Nice one. Nice relationship. We are moving together. If it is rallies, we are going together from there and back again. Through together. We are working in harmony.
Sure. Everything worked together.
Sure. So you think most of them was ZANU-PF? Or who are they with? The farm workers?
Can say yes, can say no. Don't know.
Are you going to vote, Biggie?
No, I'm not going to vote. I'm scared because they see they are looking at us, the four men, how we are going to vote. That's what's making me scared.
You're definitely going to vote. We'll be here over elections. What could happen is a reality. It's not, especially in this locale, it is a very real threat. We'll just have to play it by ear.
I wish I had a crystal ball to find out. No, I think it would be silly of us to stay vulnerable. Where we feel vulnerable, we will.
I will move if it's life threatening.
If it's life threatening.
Zimbabwe shall ever remain the heritage of Zimbabwe.
Voting in the countryside was uneventful, in contrast to the city where 500,000 voters were registered and large queues led to voter discontent.
buttons. I'm bringing them food. I'm from giving my people food in there. But it's them. This is fungus, everybody. We've been saying that they've deliberately reduced the number of polling stations in town so that they can avoid this. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Despite widespread allegations of political intimidation and electoral irregularities, for the people of Zimbabwe, this election would determine their future for many years to come.
When we went to war, we never fought for elections. We fought to liberate. We didn't fight to vote.
We are at the National Election Command Center at Mkwati Building here in Harare, and I'm joined once again by members of the Election Directorate, who include Chairman Dr. Maria Wanda Nzua.
The results were announced throughout the night, and the country was suspended on a razor edge.
The election
director. Do hereby declare Robert Gabriel Mugabe of ZANU-PF Party, who has received the majority of the total number of the valid votes cast, the winner of the presidential election for the office of the president of the Republic of Zimbabwe.
His supporters were ecstatic. They celebrated Morgan Tsvangirai's electoral funeral. This is a country deeply divided. Robert Mugabe has promised his people white farmers' land.
Now where do we go? Now what do? We had some hope. Now the hope is just, I don't know. Not the devastation in losing things. It's the principle of the fact that this is our home. We have no other place to be. And somebody can actually tell us that because we have been either, I don't know whether it's the farming, or we are not welcome in our own country. 20 years down the line from independence, where we have supported, paid taxes, done this, done that, we have paid our dues to our country.
At first I told you I'm not going to vote. Now I've changed the decision because I just wanted to please them. The leader of the office was also supervising on the polling station.
How do you feel about the ZANU victory?
They won the ZANU, I can't say anything.
What?
I came to the conclusion that socio-economic rights and democracy cannot be separated. Although the land issue was central to the campaign, the liberation movement also stood for one man, one vote, freedom of assembly, freedom of association, and press freedom. In the 1970s, Mugabe had taught us that economic and political rights need to be combined. However, he seems to have conveniently forgotten this critical lesson.